Not here in, right? We're not hearing. What happened?
Merciful God, the story of the landowner and the worker turns our ideas about fairness upside down. We probably would agree with the workers who complained about the seemingly blatantly unfair action of the landowner. We may puzzle over this parable and dismiss it as not really applying to us. But every time we suppose that our faithfulness, our status, our piety gives us special claim on your favor, we need to hear the story of your abundant grace. Forgive us when we measure the behavior of ourselves, of others, rather than measuring our behavior against yours. Your divine generosity astounds us and calls into question our values and our selfishness. Open our eyes to see beyond our own needs and unclench our hands to share what we have with those in need. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We are enabled to live our lives in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ because of the generous love of God. For if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Thanks be to God. Let's stand and sing our chorus of confession, Change My Heart, O God. Let's remain standing and say our statement of faith together. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. We eagerly listen for a word from you, Lord Jesus Christ, to help us in our daily life and to equip us for the mission to which you have called us. Let's remain standing and sing our children's hymn, Love is a Flag, during which time we'll be picking up the rebuilding offering. I don't think we have time with the children this morning. Please be seated. We'll sing our hymn of illumination, Open My Eyes That I May See.
Thank you.
Father, we now pray that you would illumine our minds more and more as we look to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Open our eyes to see wondrous things in your word of truth. Open our ears to hear your still, small voice speaking to us the words of life. And open our minds and cleanse our thoughts so that your Holy Spirit may guide us in all truth. May we be increasingly willing to submit to his gentle promptings so that he may guide us into your way of peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Red Word, the Holy Scriptures. Our first reading is taken from Exodus chapter 16, verses 2 to 15, bread and quails to feed the people.
There in the desert, they all complained to Moses and Aaron and said to them, "We wish that the Lord had killed us in Egypt. There we could at least sit down and eat meat and as much other food as we wanted. But you have brought us out into the desert to starve us all to death." The Lord said to Moses, "Now I am going to cause food to rain down from the sky for all of you. The people must go out every day and gather enough for that day. In this way, I can test them to find out if they will follow my instructions. So on the sixth day, they are to bring in twice as much as usual and prepare it." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "This evening you will know that it was the Lord who brought you out of Egypt. In the morning you will see the dazzling light of the Lord's presence. He has heard your complaints against him. Yes, against him, because we are all only carrying out his instructions." Then Moses said, "It is the Lord who will give you meat to eat in the evening and as much bread as you want in the morning, because he has heard how much you have complained against him. When you complain against us, you are really complaining against the Lord." Moses said to Aaron, "Tell the whole community to come and stand before the Lord, because he has heard their complaints." As Aaron spoke to the whole community, they turned towards the desert, and suddenly the dazzling light of the Lord appeared in a cloud. The Lord said to Moses, "I have heard the complaints of the Israelites. Tell them at twilight they will have meat to eat, and in the morning they will have all the bread they want. Then they will know that I, the Lord, am their God." In the evening, a large flock of quails flew in, enough to cover the camp, and in the morning there was dew all around the camp. When the dew evaporated, there was something thin and flaky on the surface of the desert. It was as delicate as frost. And when the Israelites saw it, they didn't know what it was and asked each other, "What is it?" And Moses said to them, "This is the food that the Lord has given you to eat." The word of the Lord.
By the way, we have things for the kids to color at the back. So if anybody would like to do that, please feel free to do so. Our responsive psalm is Psalm 105. Verses 1 to 6 and 37 to 45. Make known what God has done. Give thanks to the Lord, proclaim his greatness, tell the nations what he has done. Sing praise to the Lord, tell the wonderful things he has done. Be glad that we belong to him. Let all who worship him rejoice. Go to the Lord for help and worship him continually. You descendants of Abraham, his servant, you descendants of Jacob, the man he chose, remember the miracles that God performed and the judgments that he gave. Then he led the Israelites out. They carried silver and gold, and all of them were healthy and strong. The Egyptians were afraid of them and were glad when they left. God put a cloud over his people, and fire at night to give them light. They asked, and he sent quails. He gave them food from heaven to satisfy them. He opened a rock, and water gushed out, flowing through the desert like a river. He remembered his sacred promise to Abraham, his servant. So he led his chosen people out, and they sang and shouted for joy. He gave them the lands of other peoples and let them take over their fields so that his people would obey his laws and keep all his commands. Praise the Lord. Our epistle reading is taken from Philippians 1, verses 21 to 30. For me to live is Christ.
For what is life? To me, it is Christ. Death, then, will bring more. But if by continuing to live, I can do more worthwhile work, then I am not sure which I should choose. I am pulled in two directions. I want very much to leave this life and be with Christ, which is a far better thing. But for your sake, it is much more important that I remain alive. I am sure of this, and so I know that I will stay. I will stay on with you all to add to your progress and joy in the faith, so that when I am with you again, you will have even more reason to be proud of me in your life, in union with Christ Jesus. Now, the important thing is that your way of life should be as the gospel of Christ requires, so that whether or not I'm able to go and see you, I will hear that you are standing firm with one common purpose, and that with only one desire, you are fighting together for the faith of the gospel. Don't be afraid of your enemies. Always be courageous, and this will prove to them that they will lose and that you will win, because it is God who gives you the victory. For you have been given the privilege of serving Christ, not only by believing in him, but also by suffering for him. Now you can take part with me in the battle. It is the same battle you saw me fighting in the past, and as you hear, the one I am fighting still. The word of the Lord.
Our gospel reading is taken from Matthew 20, verse 1 to 16. Daily wages for the laborers, what's fair?
The kingdom of heaven is like this. Once there was a man who went out early in the morning to hire some men to work in his vineyard. He agreed to pay them the regular wage, a silver coin a day, and sent them to work in his vineyard. He went out again to the marketplace at 9 o'clock and saw some men standing there doing nothing. So he told them, "You also go and work in the vineyard, and I will pay you a fair wage." So they went. Then at 12 o'clock and again at 3 o'clock, he did the same thing. It was nearly 5 o'clock when he went to the marketplace and saw some other men still standing there. "Why are you wasting the whole day here doing nothing?" he asked them. "No one hired us," they answered. "Well then, you go and work in the vineyard," he told them. When evening came, the owner told his foreman, "Call the workers and pay them their wages, starting with those who were hired last and ending with those who were hired first. The men who had begun to work at 5 o'clock were paid a silver coin each. So when the men who were the first to be hired came to be paid, they thought they would get more, but they too were given a silver coin each. They took their money and started grumbling against the employer. These men who were hired last worked only 1 hour, they said, while we put up with a whole day's work in the hot sun. Yet you paid them the same as you paid us. Listen, friend, the owner answered one of them, I have not cheated you. After all, you agreed to do a day's work for 1 silver coin. Now take your pay and go home. I want to give this man who was hired last as much as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do as I wish with my own money? Or are you jealous because I am generous? And Jesus concluded, so those who are last will be first, and those who are first will be last. The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ.
We will now have a special music by Richard, followed by the sermon by Reverend Dr. James.
Thank you very much, Richard. Recently, we heard of the unfortunate death of a medical student from Canada. And in remarks made by his parents, as reported in this weekend's online version of the New Today newspaper, among the things they said, they noted that it doesn't make sense. It just seems so unexpected The life of our son has just been cut short from reasons that are unfathomable. Unquote. Do you believe that a person can die before his or her time? An untimely death assumes that a person was born to live a certain number of years and had a purpose to fulfill that he or she was unable to fulfill because his or her life was cut short. Although pragmatically, I believe that one can die before his or her time, philosophically, I do not believe in untimely deaths. From the point of view of the all-knowing God, the day, the time, the moment of each death is already known. Though God may not be the agent or the cause of the deaths, during my own time of illness, especially while I was awaiting my diagnosis, I found it comforting to reflect on the fact that God already knew the day and the time of my death, and that I will not die a moment sooner. Paul was imprisoned in Rome, and he did not know what the outcome of his trial would be. However, he was convinced that whatever the outcome, it would be a win-win situation for him. Because were he to be executed, he would enter the eternal presence of the Lord. And if he were to live, it would be so that he would fulfill the purpose for which God had created him. I want to propose to you, therefore, that if one is living a life of obedience within the will of God, he or she will never die before his or her time. Let me say it again. I propose to you, my proposition is that if one were living a life of obedience within the will of God, he or she will never die before his or her time. The text of this morning comes from Philippians chapter 1, and although the text we read is from Philippians chapter 1, verses 21 to 30, I'm going to focus primarily on verses 21 to 26. In verse 12 of this very same chapter, chapter 1 of the book of Philippians, Paul described the circumstances of his imprisonment. He said that rather than curtailing the spread of the gospel, his imprisonment had aided its dissemination. And so it seems that although Paul was imprisoned, he was in a situation not unlike being under house arrest, which he served for 2 years in his own rented accommodation. He was guarded by a soldier. In those days, they didn't have the little electronic surveillance thing on your foot. But he had what might have been a light chain on his feet, on his foot, that would be connected to the single soldier that was guarding him. And so although he could not leave his immediate environs, he could entertain visitors. And in the passage before us, Paul speaks about his attitude towards death and described it not as something onerous or to be dreaded, but rather as an occasion to be welcomed and celebrated. For Paul, as it should be for all believers, death is not a destination, but a debut. Our entrance onto the stage of eternity into the presence of our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. And so I have 3 points coming out of this text which I would like to expand on. The first is that the person who believes in Christ and whose life is dedicated to serving him will not be afraid of death. The second is that a person who lives within God's will, a life of obedience, will not die before his or her time. And thirdly, when the time to die comes, the believer who lives for his Lord will embrace it. And so the first point, the person who believes in Christ and whose life is dedicated to serving him will not be afraid of death. Now, I make a distinction between dying and death. Dying can sometimes be quite painful, both mentally and physically. But the actual event of death itself is something that we should not be afraid of. The philosopher Epicurus said that we, and he was not speaking from the point of view of religious persons, but just philosophically speaking, he said, death is not something of which we should be afraid. Because when we are here, death is not here. And when death is here, we are not here. Just philosophically speaking. Paul said, for me, if I were to die, I am going to be with the Lord. But if I were to live, it is so that I may perform the reason for which I live. The idea is this, that for the believer, when he or she dies, the body which I enflesh, the soul, the spirit, may decay, but that spirit goes to be with God. In the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 12, the writer says that all must go to the eternal home, and the mourners will go about the streets, and the dust returns to the earth as it was, and the breath returns to God who gave it. The idea that at the time that we die, we go to be with God, was illustrated in the response that Jesus gave to the thief on the cross. We are told in Luke's gospel, but the other rebuked him, saying, do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong. And then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus replied, truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. We believe that at the moment of death, the believer's soul, the believer's spirit, goes to be with God. Paul himself described the body as a covering, as a tent. And he said this in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. For I know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this tent we groan, longing to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, if indeed when we have taken it off, we will not be found naked. For while we are still in this tent, the body, we groan under our burden, because we wish not to be unclothed, but to be further clothed, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. He who has prepared for us this very thing is God, who has given us the Spirit as a guarantee. And so we are always confident, even though we know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we walk by faith and not by sight. Yes, we do have confidence, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him. This is not somebody speaking who is afraid of death. In verse 23 of Philippians chapter 1, the word that is rendered depart suggests an unhitching of a tent. That one is pulling up stakes so that he may travel and pitch tent somewhere else. Or of a boat being loosed from its moorings so that it may set sail to another destination. One writer that I read in my preparation for this said that during the battle for London, during the Second World War, the pilots who sacrificed their life for country were never ever described as having died, but rather as having been posted to a new station. And so the idea about death is that death is not a destination, but death is a means by which we enter the eternal presence of God. And so Paul says, I have nothing to lose. The second point I want to make is that a person who lives within God's will, a life of obedience, will not die before his or her time. Paul says, look, I am in a strait between the two. I cannot make up my mind. I'm ambivalent. I don't know whether or not it's better for me to just die and be with the Lord or to live. However, he says, I am confident of this fact that if I were to live, it would be for your good. So Paul speaks about being alive for a particular purpose. Although he was not afraid to die, he felt that were he to live a bit longer, it would be for the benefit of the believers and the glory of God. Sisters and brothers, there are so many people who are just existing. They get up every day and their life has no purpose. They may be working. They may be engaged in activities, but they have no fulfillment, and they don't feel as though life is rewarding. We must each ensure that we are engaged in the purpose for which God has created us. And I have always said in the past, and I reiterate at this moment, that each person was created for a specific purpose. And often that purpose might be found in our proclivities, in the gifts, and in the talents that God has given us. But whatever it is, to be of any real good, it must be for the honor and the glory of God. It is not about getting wealthy. It is not about getting famous. But if we were to get famous, if we were to get wealthy, we must see our fame and our wealth as opportunities to glorify God. And finally, our life must be purposeful and should benefit others in such a way that they are desirous of knowing intimately and experientially the God we serve. And Paul says that he looks forward to the time when he'll be able to come to the Philippians so they may be able to imitate his own life. The final point is that when the time to die comes, the believer who lives for his Lord will embrace it. If one has lived a purposeful and fulfilling life in the service of God, at whatever age death comes, he or she will have a sense of accomplishment and see death as a causeway and not as a destination. The scriptures gives us some examples of individuals who at the time of death were not concerned that they were gonna die, but were more concerned that those they were leaving behind would be faithful in their service of God. I wanna share with you three examples, two from the Old Testament and one from the New. The first one is Joshua. In Joshua chapter 23, Joshua says this, I am about to go the way of all the earth. That's his description of death. And now I'm about to go the way of all the earth, and you know in your heart and souls, all of you, that not one thing has failed of all the good things that the Lord your God promised concerning you. All have come to pass for you. Not one of them has failed. But just as all the good things that the Lord God promised concerning you have been fulfilled for you, so the Lord will bring upon you all the bad things until he has destroyed you from this good land that the Lord your God has given you, if you transgress the covenant of the Lord your God, which he enjoined on you, and go and serve other gods and bow down to them. And then King David. When King David's time to die drew near, he charged his son Solomon, saying, I'm about to go the way of all the earth. Be strong, be courageous, and keep the charge of the Lord your God, walking in his ways and keeping his statutes, his commandments, his ordinances, and his testimonies, as it is written in the law of Moses, so that you may prosper in all that you do, wherever you turn. And finally, Paul. Here in Philippians, we see Paul saying, I'm not sure where I want to be, alive or with the Lord. But in the second letter that he wrote to Timothy, he had come to the place where he was convinced that he had served his purpose. And so he wrote to Timothy the following words. As for me, I'm already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. I cannot remember who the singer was, but there is a line in a song that says, everyone wants to go to heaven, but no one wants to die. I do not believe that that line should apply to Christians. It does not mean that we have a death wish or that we want to die at this very moment. But it does mean that we understand that once we are living within God's will, a life of obedience, we will live and we will die at God's gracious pleasure. And so in your life, ensure that your life is being lived for the good of mankind and the glory of God. Amen.
We respond with thanksgiving through commitment of ourselves and giving of tithes and offerings. Let us stand and sing our hymn of response, Rejoice, the Lord is King. Please be seated as we pick up our offering. God of many blessings, we respond to your generosity with these gifts praying that they and the service of our lives may be used to benefit those in need and to share the gospel of Christ. Amen. We take our prayers to the Father, who is always willing to hear us through Christ, our High Priest and Mediator, in the power of the Holy Spirit, our enabler and guide. Do we have any family updates? Sonia's birthday is tomorrow. Any other birthdays? Maria and Emma have birthdays today. Anybody else? Oh, okay. Do you want to come to the mic?
There's a quote that I like. Passion drives purpose, and purpose ignites passion. Rev spoke about purpose, and I'm here this morning to share the good news as a teacher. My purpose, I think, in life, God brought me down to teach. And my passion has always been the teaching of geography. Since I retired, I've been doing part-time, but starting Monday, I have been given the opportunity to be back in the classroom as a part-time teacher. Thanks be to God for that. I'm so grateful.
Birthday. We'll now have the prayers of thanksgiving and of the people. Dear Lord, as we come to you this morning, I pray that you would renew our spirits and invigorate us for the coming week. We are grateful to have this opportunity to spend time in your presence with one another. We thank you for the privilege of living on this beautiful island that we call home. Thank you for everything you do for us each day, in particular for all we take for granted, your generosity, the grace you extend to us, and every moment, big or small, of joy and beauty in our lives. And we thank you that even when we endure hardship, and even when we feel low, that you are with us always, there to help us if we only ask. We lift before you the members of our church family who are unwell or recovering from illness. We pray that you would comfort and strengthen them, and we ask the same for their caregivers. We also lift before you those in our wider community who are struggling, whether from illness, physical or mental, financial hardship, isolation and loneliness, or lack of hope and opportunity. Help us all to have more empathy and compassion and to do more to care for others with what we have. We ask that you guide the decision-making of those in leadership positions, world leaders, our own government here in Grenada, those who lead in our communities, in business and in educational institutions. Inspire us, young and old, to put our best foot forward every day, and to treat others as you would. We ask your blessing on our minister, our congregation, and all those who are a part of our extended church family. We are grateful to have this sanctuary to gather in, and we ask that you bless our efforts to care for and complete it. All these things we ask in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. We go, having heard your word to us, to make a difference in our communities and the world. Our hymn of sending forth, crown him with many crowns. Please stand.
And wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments, and how inscrutable his ways. For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Please be seated. If through the fellowship, the liturgy, the hymns, the reading of scripture, the special music or the sermon, God has spoken to you and you desire to make a profession of faith, recommitment of life, become a member of this congregation, make a pledge, or just to talk, please contact the minister to arrange an appointment. Our announcements. Our building fund is collected on the fourth Sunday of every month, which we did today. Bible study every Thursday at 5 p.m. at the Felicity Julian Memorial Hall, that's downstairs. Communion on the 1st of October, which is also World Communion Sunday. And the Kirk's annual fundraising brunch is carded for Sunday, the 29th of October, 2023, I believe. Dr. James's second half of his vacation will be from October 30th to November 13th. Any other announcements?
Good morning. So we have announce the brunch, but we may have to make some adjustments because of the availability of the venue. Anyway, it is whatever we're having, it's going to be the 29th of October. And I am wanting to spend 5 minutes after church with the Women's Guild and anyone else who would like to volunteer to help us with this fundraising event. I have a pad at the back for your name and your contacts. Thank you.
All right, let us stand and sing our recessional. We are His hands.
Thank you.
The peace of the risen Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Have a great day, everyone.